Hello and welcome. It's Alexa Linton here, your host for the Whole Horse Podcast. We're here to look at all the ways that the horse industry is changing before our very eyes in very cool, very amazing ways. And we're chatting with the people at the forefront of that change, the professionals, the trainers, the body workers, the researchers that are helping our lives with horses become better and better. Thanks for being here. I love that you're here and listening and learning. And if you ever have a guest that you want to suggest or a topic that you want to hear, just let me know and I'd love to hear from you. Thanks for listening. It means a lot. And I look forward to seeing you for season 4. Hi, everyone. It's Alexa Linton here, and you're here on the Whole Horse Podcast, and it's the beginning of season 4. And I'm here today with, someone I am really excited to be talking to. I'm here with Warwick Schiller today. Thank you for being here, Warwick.
Hey, glad to be. Thanks for having me.
Oh, you're so welcome. It's a real honor. I've been watching more of your recent work, and there's, you know, as I was sharing before, I really trust my nervous system, my gut now. I've really learned to kind of, you know, sit into, okay, how do I feel when I'm watching something happen or seeing a horse respond? And there's been a few of your recent videos, and I've just been feeling this, like, you know, this rush of relaxation come over me, this sort of really lovely feeling, and watching that horse, watching how listened to and heard that horse is during those moments. And I have to admit, this is kind of, it's a rare thing for me. And I really want to dive in today, Warwick, around, you know, what's got you here? You know, I've been listening to some of your story and, you know, the changes that you've made, the horses that have kind of been the pivot points on that, so to speak. And I would love you to share a little bit more about, you know, that aspect of your story. I know you got lots going on, and you've come from a lot of horsemanship and a lot of amazing work. You know, what were those big shifting points for you along your journey with horses that got you to the point you are at today?
You know, there's an old saying that says something like it's what you learn after you know everything that's important, something like that. And, you know, I had been, I've just passed 20 million views on my YouTube channel, but about five years ago, I didn't have that many, but there was quite a few there. And I was doing clinics around the world, and I have a big online video subscription that's my main business. And all that was going really well. And so, you know, and I'm going around the world helping people at their clinics, people bring me the horse, you know, I helped with the horse, the whole bit. And so I was kind of believing what I was doing, like, yeah, I'm right. I know what I'm doing. And then my wife bought a reining horse, and he was functionally, you know, as far as reining goes, he was functional, but he just had a level of tightness about him that stopped him from being like, he's physically, he's a superstar, can do all the really hard stuff, but just has a little level of tension underneath that stops him from being able to exhibit that in the show pen. And I said, yeah, buy him, I can fix all that stuff, you know. And I couldn't, and nothing I had done before could get into this horse. And so I kind of stepped back from trying to change him. I left him here he was, like, I'm not getting anywhere. So, and I think that kind of planted the seed that, okay, what you're doing is not the be all to end all. And so I started looking around at different other things. I wasn't doing anything. I was just, I think a part of my mind opened up to other possibilities. And so I was looking at probably at things that I hadn't looked at before, in ways I hadn't looked at before. And the catalyst was I was doing a clinic in Texas, and this is about 4 years ago now. Mm-hmm. And there was a Mustang at this clinic who, you know, he's 9 years old, been out of the wild for 6 years, you know, came out of the wild when he was 3. And, you know, he does all the groundwork, rides fine, but every once in a while, out of the blue, he will bolt. And there seems to be no trigger for it. The owner had the horse in the clinic, but the trainer was also in the clinic. And I asked, and she's, you know, I respect her opinion. And I said, so what's the trigger? You know, because you, I don't solve issues. I solve the things that cause the issues and the issues go away. And I want to know what the trigger was for causing the bolt. And she said, honestly, I can't tell because it's never the same thing. It's kind of random. And it could be something that yesterday didn't bother him and today it does. And I really don't know. And I thought, well, that's interesting. It was a 3-day clinic. And the first day we did some sort of groundwork. I don't really, you know, I can't really remember exactly what we did because I don't remember. So it wasn't that crazy. The second day when she came in, we started doing some more groundwork. And she was actually, what she was working on was walking down beside a horse and just asking him to step over behind, just disengage mm-hmm. behind. And she said, hey, I got a problem over here. He's starting to block me out. And a lot of times when people go to walk down beside a horse and disengage them, they mentally start thinking about doing it before they actually move their feet. And so they're actually getting the horse to move its hind end over before they move their feet. And the horse moves its hind end over as they try to walk down there, and its head kind of moves mm-hmm. towards them. And they think the horse is blocking them out, but they're not. They're just mentally getting ahead of themselves. They're not present. They're, you know, they're 5 seconds ahead of themselves mentally. And I said, well, let me have a look. And that's what I expected he would do, is I would just be present and I'd walk down that side and he'd let me, but he didn't. I went to walk down that side of him and he turned his head. He didn't pivot, but he just turned his head and kind of blocked me. And normally I would just reach under his jaw with my left hand and just move his head over so that mm-hmm. I'm now in his left eye. And then I'd continue down that side. I'd say, you know, there wouldn't be any repercussions. There's no punishment for it. But I would normally say, excuse me, I'd like to be on this side, move his head without moving my feet. Because at the time I was thinking if I move my feet, I lose, he wins. That was my mentality yep. at the time. But I didn't do that. Some of the stuff I'd been reading, when he turned his head, I just stepped back and I basically said, I see your concern. And I stepped back and I waited, you know, so I stepped back to the front of him, back from where I came from. And I waited, you know, for a minute or so until he'd showed me some sign of relaxing again. Maybe he started blinking, you know, maybe his eyes stopped blinking, maybe his ears mm-hmm. stopped moving. I'm not sure what it was at the time, but some indication he'd processed that and he was ready to go again. And so then I went to walk down there again and he did the same thing and I stepped back. And this went on for, I don't really remember, somewhere between 5 and 10 minutes. And at some point in time, I can now walk down beside him and he doesn't block me out. And I thought, okay, this horse has been ridden for 6 years, so obviously I could touch him with no ill effects. So I just reached out to put my hand on his neck. And as my hand approached his neck, his head raised up a couple inches. And I think his eyes stopped blinking. So I just pulled my hand back and I stepped back and I said, hey, I saw that too. And then I went back around to the front, started again. He would let me walk down his side, but I'd go to touch him on the neck and he would raise his head up just imperceptibly, but it was enough to tell me I'm slightly concerned. Took my hand away, stepped back. And this went on for, once again, 5 or 10 minutes until I could walk down beside him. He didn't block me out. I could take my hand and put it on his neck and he didn't tighten up at all. And then I thought, okay, I'm going to disengage him. And I think it's the disengaging he doesn't like. I bet when I disengage him one time, if I walk back to the front, when I go to walk down the side, he's going to block me out. I think he doesn't like the disengaging. So I asked him to disengage and he'd been trained perfectly well to do that. So he did it perfectly. Then I walked back to the front and I walked down the side and he let me do it, let me disengage him. I thought I'll do it again. So I went back to the front, went down the side, disengaged him, did that 5 or 6 times and he disengaged perfectly, but he let me walk down there every single time. And there was no training involved. I didn't fix his head. I didn't fix a disengage. Mm-hmm. I didn't do anything. I just listened to him. And I said to the owner, I said, here you go. I handed the lead rope back to her and I said, it seems to be fine now. And she said, well, what do you want me to do? And I said, I would just stand there with him, just stand there and just let him digest that for, you know, for a minute, and then we'll think of something else to do. And I went off to help somebody else in the clinic, and about 10 minutes later there's a collective gasp from everybody in the clinic, and I turned and looked, and this horse has buckled at the knees and just dropped to his belly. Yep. And he's snoring dust clouds in the dirt. And then he has a roll, gets up, shakes, and then buckles and boom, down he goes again. And I said to her, is that normal? Because if it's normal, it's not a big deal. You know, it doesn't mean anything. And I said, is that normal? She said, I've seen him lay down once in 6 years and he was out in the pasture. And when I showed up on the horizon, he jumped up. But I don't ever see him lay down. And I have a, well, I don't do it these days, but I used to have a morning group and an afternoon group at clinics. So I have 12 people in clinics. I have six in the morning, six in the afternoon. Now I have, I split into groups of three for 2 hours. But he was in the morning group, and this was probably about 10:30 or something or other. And he slept till we broke for lunch, and we actually woke him up at lunchtime, and she put him away. And the next morning, so the third day of the clinic, she leads him back in, and she said, "What do you want me to do?" And I said, "I would just stand with him. Let's just see what he does." And after about 15 minutes, boom, down he went, and he slept for 4 hours in the arena with the loudspeaker on, with other horses riding around under saddle, horses cantering past him. And I came home from that clinic. I'm like, I'm not sure what happened then, but something happened. And I didn't, it was the first time I'd ever made a change in a horse that I didn't train the horse. There was no training involved. There was no telling them what to do or fixing anything. It was just listening. It was just what I've now come to know as the term attunement, being seen, being heard. Mm. And I also, I came home and I looked up sleeping habits of horses or whatever in there, and I realized, I knew horses could sleep standing up, but what I didn't realize is they can only nap standing up. They need to be able to lay down to get that deep REM sleep. Mm-hmm. And I realized this horse had probably not had any REM sleep for a long time. And we know, we can't ask the horse what he thinks, but we know from humans, if you don't get enough REM sleep, you can be irritable or anxious. And I really think this horse is, but I've got to finish the story. And so that was 4 years ago. The horse mm-hmm. has not bolted since.
Wow.
And so we solved a bolting issue by letting the horse know that we saw their level of concern. That's it. And so that was the start of the whole thing. I knew something crazy had happened at that clinic, and I wasn't exactly sure what. And I came home, looked up the sleeping habits of horses, learned about the REM, the laying down, all that sort of stuff. And that really sent me down a rabbit hole of what can I do by just listening, just being attuned, just paying attention to the little details. And it's really changed the way I interact with horses and probably the world, really, but horses especially.
Wow. I'm getting this compiling of so many different, pieces, the work of Elsa Sinclair, the work of Sharon Wilsey around horse speak, and these Anna Blake and calming signals, this sense of what happens when we, number one, listen on that depth of level, what role we kind of take on for that horse, that they feel protected, that they feel safe in that space, how safe that horse needed to feel to drop and sleep for that long with, like you said, everything going on for him. Quite amazing to hear that. And I know as a body worker, I've been involved with horses that, they don't sleep because it hurts. It hurts to go down, and they're vastly aware that getting up is hard. They don't have the strength in their legs to push up, and it's dangerous for them. I really thank you for bringing that up. And it sounds like it was quite a profound experience. So what's kind of happened since then? So that was 4 years ago. Where has that taken you?
Well, that was an interesting year because, once you see that, you can't unsee that.
Yeah.
And so I spent the rest of the year, so that was 2017, I think. Yeah, it was 2017. I spent the rest of the year doing clinics, and having people show up expecting me to give them all the answers. I'm supposed to know what the answers are, and having me say, I have no idea what I'm doing. I'm not going to do what you thought I was going to do. I'm not going to do what you've seen in the videos. I'm actually trying something, so bear with me. So I spent that. It was a very, very humbling year. I spent the whole year trying things that I didn't know exactly what I was doing in front of crowds of people who have paid me. And so it was a great learning experience because, there's 12 horses at every clinic. And if I might fly across the country and do a clinic on a weekend, then a clinic in midweek, and then a clinic on the weekend. So in 10 days, I get to work with 36 different horses and see different changes come about. And It was that year that horses started laying down. There's a few would lay down at clinics that hadn't laid down much. But since then, I get it a lot to where horses at clinics will lay down and I'll say, is that normal? Sometimes it's normal, but a lot of times they go, no, this horse doesn't ever really lay down. And it just comes from that whole attunement thing. So where it's taken from there, I've learned how to listen more and more and more and be able to notice smaller and smaller things and let those horses know that I notice those smaller and smaller things. And so it's really changed. And then that led me to, so I knew it was working and I wasn't sure why. And that led me to polyvagal theory. And when I learned about polyvagal theory, then I go, now I completely understand why it works, because it's that, you know, you're engaging that ventral vagal complex, that social engagement complex. Yep. And that really, learning about that really made it, oh yeah, now I really, really understand why it's working. I knew it was working before. Now I kind of really understand why it's working. And the whole thing really led me down a rabbit hole of understanding that, because I didn't understand about me in the first place, but the whole thing led me down a rabbit hole, realizing that I had been shut down. I was shut down. And I've spent the last 3 years doing various things, going to therapists, things like that, that have started to bring me out of that. And it takes you down that whole trauma rabbit hole and repressed things rabbit hole and lack of attunement rabbit hole. And it's pretty interesting. And it really changes the way you look at the world, because once you start to, you know what, I was what you'd probably call a high-functioning hypo-arousal. You know, there's hyper-arousal, there's hypo-arousal. I was high-functioning shut down.
Yeah.
You know, to the outside world, it looks like I'm having a jolly good time. And I thought I was too. You know, I always thought, you know, I had the perfect childhood. You know, there was no abuse, there's no trauma, there's no this, there's no that. But I kind of feel like I'm as messed up as the people who had big problems. But anyway, I always thought I had the perfect childhood, and I thought, you know, everything was just fine. And then when I started going in this rabbit hole, I realized, oh no, it wasn't just fine. It's all just very, very shoved down, you know. There's a lot of stuff just shoved down in there. And that really, you know, understanding that about me and having lived that, I can really see it in a lot of horses. Horses are very, very good at shutting stuff down. I mean, you know, in the wild, they are very, very good at hiding infirmary, you know, lameness. You know, if they've got a sore leg or whatever, they don't just hobble around and look for sympathy, because the only attention you're going to get is from the mountain lions or whatever. So you kind of have that, I'm okay, I'm fine. Yep, no worries. But I think they're just as good at doing that emotionally. And that's where a lot of problems come from. And I really think where horses lie on a spectrum determines whether they're going to show that outwardly or they're going to shut it down inwardly. You know, like some horses have a lot of outward anxiety, and you see them being the problematic horses. They're the ones that rear and buck and bolt and spook and do all those things that people don't want. But then you see the other kind that are just kind of shut down and gone inside themselves. And they're the same horse, except it's just presented differently.
Yeah, and with those ones, I find as you know, doing my work, it's so internally harmful, you know, in those horses oftentimes, you know, digestively.
Oh yeah.
Because they've got this nervous system, you know, dysfunction going on. Their regulation is they're dysregulated. The autonomics, the sympathetics are pumped high. Yeah. So I know that you've been on this path of, you know, it sounds like with doing therapy. I heard you chat on a video the other day about doing a men's retreat for a weekend and, you know, looking at these different aspects around, you know, the emotions that we feel, you know, the things that we feel okay expressing or safe expressing and the things that we don't. So how has that journey impacted you? What are you noticing in your body and in your way of being in the world that's changed in the last, you know, 3 or 4 years?
I spent a year doing, seeing a therapist, both individual therapy and group therapy, that really didn't do anything for me. So I, you know, all this start, and a lot of this started that same year, about a month or so after the Mustang thing. I was at a horse expo and someone mentioned the name Brené Brown to me. Mm-hmm, and I had never heard of Brené Brown. I came home and got a book of Brené Brown's, which I think was The Power of Vulnerability, was the first one I started with. But in there, she was saying that you cannot selectively suppress emotions. If you suppress the lower emotions, fear, grief, sadness, all that sort of stuff, you automatically suppress the higher ones. And I know, you know, growing up in my generation, you know, you don't show fear. In my family, you don't show grief. You know, you go to a funeral and you go, oh, well, he died. Life goes on. But I'd never thought about those higher emotions. So I actually looked into a type of therapy called DBT, dialectical behavior therapy. And it was originally, I think it was originally started for highly suicidal adults, but now they use it for anybody with emotional regulation issues. And so I went to a therapist and told her what I wanted to do. And she goes, oh yeah, this will be easy. We have group therapy, but you don't need to do that. And after about 3 months of getting nowhere, she goes, you know what, you probably should come to the group therapy too. And so I did that for a whole year and I didn't get anywhere, because what I realized is, in order for that therapy to work, you actually have to have some emotions to regulate. You have to have some emotions that are dysregulated. If you don't have any emotions, they're not working with anything. Yeah. I learned a lot of cool stuff there. It just didn't help with the emotion stuff. Then the next thing I did was I did a doctor administrated ketamine trip, which was here in Silicon Valley, which I read about this in Game Changers. Dave Asprey is his name.
Okay, yeah.
And so he interviewed 300 people, 300 or 400 people in a couple of years, and then he basically took all, and at the end of every interview we asked him, so give me three things that were invaluable to you becoming successful or whatever. And then he basically compiled all those three things out of the 400 people into common denominators, and he wrote a book called Game Changers. And like the first chapter is meditation. Everybody had a meditation practice. But later in the book, he's talking about a doctor in Silicon Valley who does stuff with stem cells, where he'll pull fat out of you, spin your stem cells off, and inject them into like your joints if you've had sports injuries and stuff. And then he said, but he will also do that and inject your own stem cells into your vagus nerve and give you a complete emotional reset. And I'm thinking,
oh my gosh,
you mean I don't need to go to the therapy for this? Like, you can just do a thing? And so I came home and I read that in the book. And so I looked at the doctor up, and we had to do a phone interview, a phone appointment for about an hour. And he asked me a lot of questions, and he said, yeah, we call that a stellate ganglion block.
Yeah, yeah.
We're not going to do that with you based on what you've told me. I'm going to do something different with you. So I went into his office and they put me on a bag, you know, an IV drip of something called NAD for about 4.5 hours.
Okay.
NAD is a cofactor, whatever a cofactor is. And you're born with a certain amount of it and it deteriorates as time goes on. But it has something to do with the functioning of your gut and your, you know, your gut, gut, brain, heart, superhighway sort of thing. And then they gave me this ketamine trip. He had a Qigong energy healer come in the room with me, and they gave me this ketamine trip. And the next day, boom, I had these gut sensations kick in that I've never ever had before. And the next day I had to fly to Washington State to do a horse expo. And the horse expo was in very, very southern Washington, just over the Oregon border. And wherever that place is, I can't remember where it is, but everywhere there, everybody there takes their dogs everywhere. And this horse expo was no different.
Yep.
And the people that run the horse expo, the fairgrounds had said, you know what, we're not going to allow dogs at this thing. And the people that run the horse expo said, if you don't allow people to bring their dogs, no one will come. And so there's dogs everywhere, which is great because I love dogs. So I was like, you know, when I'm away at a horse expo, I don't get to be around my dogs. So I kind of miss them, but there's dogs there. So I'm patting all these dogs and carrying. But I was sitting in the booth, you know, just sitting there one day chilling. And a lady had walked by leading a cat. It's got a harness on and she's leading this cat, which was interesting. Anyway, she walked by. But when she came back by again, that cat took one look at me, made a beeline, pulled the leash out of her hand, jumped up on the table and then jumped in my lap and curled up in my lap and just sat there. And sat there for half an hour. And when the lady finally, I made conversation with the lady. When the lady finally had to go, she had to pick the cat up by the scruff of the neck like it was a kitten. It did not want to get off my lap.
Oh, my goodness.
Which was pretty interesting.
Yeah.
So that was the ketamine thing. And then about 4 months later, I went to Florida and did a three-day ayahuasca ceremony.
Yep. Yep. I have also done ayahuasca. So I'm, yeah.
So good. Yep. I don't have to try to explain it to you because you can't explain it anyway. No. There's no words. You can't put that to words. But that did, I had a bit of a heart opening at the ayahuasca. Yes. So the ketamine had a bit of a gut
shift
sort of a thing. Yeah. Yep. The ayahuasca was kind of a heart opening, but I think those kind of, you know, the value of those deteriorated after a little while.
Yep. Yeah.
Then I started doing EMDR.
Yep. Absolutely. Did a bit of
EMDR. And yep. The first day I did the EMDR, I felt like a heart shift. And funnily enough, the next day I went into atrial fibrillation.
Oh my goodness. I just learned about atrial fibrillation.
And one of the ways the heart can kill you. Yeah.
Yeah. It's good. It wasn't ventricular fibrillation, apparently. Right. That's not good stuff.
No,
yeah.
Atrial fibrillation you can live with. But I'm in the emergency room and I'm texting my therapist, like, hey, is there any correlation between EMDR and atrial fibrillation?
Yep.
Now, there's not, but there is a correlation between trauma and atrial fibrillation.
Yes.
But I did feel a bit of a heart shifting. Early on in the EMDR, and then the EMDR kind of petered out.
Yep.
Then I started seeing a somatic experience.
I was going to say, have you done somatic experiencing? Yeah. Nice. Yeah.
That was next, and that was this year.
Yeah.
And that was starting to work. You know, I started having a lot of somatic experiences when I did a certain type of meditation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it almost got to where if I sit in a chair, put my feet flat on the floor, put my hands on my thighs and close my eyes, I would start getting tingling sensations down my legs and up my arms.
Yep.
Like I didn't even have to even start to meditate. I just, as soon as I closed my eyes, but as soon as I opened my eyes, it went away. And something the somatic experiencing therapist had me doing was, you know, I almost couldn't have somatic experiences with my eyes open. And so she had me basically doing transitions like riding a horse. She had me close my eyes, get into that where I start to feel things in my body and then open your eyes. And as soon as it started to go away, close your eyes and get it back again. And then open your eyes, and just look around the room. And she kind of got to me where I could look around the room and look at things and still be in my body. So I could be in my head and body at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
But then here, about 2 months ago, I went to you mentioned it before, it was a 3-day men's emotional resilience retreat. And that got something working in my body I've never felt before. There's a sensation, a gut sensation that I've never ever felt from any of those other things. And basically it's all working now and it's stayed working. So I'd say the thing that did the most for me was that.
Yeah.
And it's still a work in progress, but that did more for me than 3 years of different therapies, ketamine and ayahuasca.
Amazing. And have you had an opportunity to kind of unpack, you know, what the differences might have been? I mean, I have my guesses in terms of social engagement, you know, those sorts of things. But was there any aspects of that that just really kind of hit the nail on the head for you in that retreat?
I think just unpacking stuff you haven't unpacked before. You know, the retreat was 3.5 days or 3 and a bit days. We get there on Thursday evening. We had dinner and it was in Southern California in the desert, up in the hills of the desert down near Palm Springs. And this guy rented this big 6-bedroom cabin for the weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And we have dinner and then we go in the living room. We all sit down in front of the big fireplace and he says, okay, so what we're going to do is go around. I want you to introduce yourself, say your name. Tell us what you expect to get out of this and tell us something you're ashamed of that you've never told anybody before.
Wow. Whew.
And then he said, I'll go first. And he told us some stuff. I'm like, whoa.
Yep.
And that was the start of it. And so that was the start of it. So he really got you vulnerable to where you could be vulnerable. And there's something about, you know, all my therapists have been women, but there's something about being invulnerable in front of a group of men. Another thing with therapy is the therapist has got no skin in the game.
Yeah, absolutely.
They're just taking it all in. They're not telling you their fears, and they're not telling you all their deep, dark secrets. And I think there's something about a man being in a group of men who are spilling their guts to you too. Another big part of it is you start to realize that the fears you have are the same fears they have. And you think, oh, but I'm not that guy. Like there was one guy in the, there were seven of us in the retreat. And one guy was a filmmaker and he's very artistic and I wouldn't say he's effeminate, but he's very soft-spoken and he's very artistic and he's not that masculine, you know, lumberjack sort of thing. But there was a guy in the retreat who was a former UN hostage negotiator. Like, this guy's a badass. And so you've got a rounded group of humans sort of thing. And the thing that was amazing is when it all comes down to it, everybody had the same fears. We are not that different. And the things that you're ashamed of and you could never tell anybody, the badass guy's ashamed of the same thing. So that sort of thing. So they basically led us up to a thing on Saturday that they called Going Into the Abyss. And we started about 11 o'clock Saturday morning. Like we'd done some work before that. On Saturday morning, but then one at a time, you sit in a chair in the middle of the room and you're allowed to start talking and you can talk about whatever you want to talk about. And they notice when, you know, the facilitator notices when things start to come up and you'll say something and then you'll kind of change the subject and you go, hey, just go back a second to what you were just talking about and trying to open the cracks of those wounds. And that goes on for 45 minutes or an hour and you get pretty raw doing that. And then he does some somatic work with you. And that's when the stuff comes out. Like he said, we can do it standing up, we can do it sitting down, or you can do it laying down if you want to. And the first guy chose to do it laying down. And so we all ended up doing it laying down when we did it. But he would say, you know, because a lot of times when you're talking about stuff, you're mentioning family members and stuff. So he'd have you lay down. He goes, so are there any family members you'd like to invite into the room? And most people started with their father. Yeah, my father. So what's his name? I tell you the name. You go, okay, ask him to come in. So the person's laying on the floor and he goes, so-and-so, can you come in? And then he goes, is there anything you want to tell him? And before this starts, when you first lay down, he says, is there any part of your body where you feel tension? And what he would do is if there was a tense part of your body, he would put his hand on it, if it was, say, your chest or the top of your head or whatever. But if it was, say, your ankles or your knee or whatever, he'd have one of the other guys come down. And there might be a person on the floor with four or five other men around him with their hands on him in some place. And then he starts going through, you know, you got anything to say to them? And so you go through the whole thing with a certain family member and then he goes, so is there any forgiveness? Is there anything you need to forgive them for? Is there anything you want them to forgive you for? Or is there anything you want to forgive yourself for feeling about them? And it just, all this stuff comes out. And it goes on for quite a while. So there was six of us. One of them didn't do it. We started at 11 o'clock in the morning and finished at 3:30 the next morning.
Oh, my gosh.
And when you're sitting there in the chair spilling your guts, people aren't on their phones looking at the floor. They're on their chairs. Their hands are on their knees. They're leaning forward. They're looking in the eye. They're engaged with you. They're nodding. They're shaking. They're murmuring. And everybody had pretty much the same experience, like opened up stuff that had never been there before. It was profound. Wow. It was really an amazing thing. But yes, got somatic stuff going on now that I mean, never had before. And it's so interesting watching. We were watching Robin and I binge watch. My wife's name's Robin. We binge watch series on Netflix. We have seen it before. I've seen the seasons up to the current one, which is Wentworth, which is an Australian women's prison series.
Okay.
And the you know, a lot of prison shows are pretty, you know, base sort of script writing, but this stuff's really, there's a lot of really emotional stuff and people like having nervous breakdowns and the acting's really good, the writing's really good, but it's just so different for me. Like this is the sixth season or something around this. So different for me this time around watching it than it has in the past seasons because I'm feeling it. I'm not just seeing it. I'm feeling it.
Wow.
Pretty amazing. Yeah. TV itself, you know, dramatic shows now are like 3D. It's like in Brave New World that Aldous Huxley wrote, when they go to the feelies and they go to the movies and they get plugged into the seats and they're actually feeling what's going on the screen. It's a bit like that. Mm-hmm. I've never really had the feelies. I've always had the sees, you know, like you're watching it, but it's not, you don't get the somatic experiencing of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty.
Oh, amazing. It's like now you got the 3D theater thing going on. And I mean, it's an interesting thing when you get tuned in. I definitely know that as well, because it's kind of that blessing and a curse, right? Like in one way, you're like, oh my gosh, I'm feeling so much. And in another way, you're like, oh my gosh, I'm feeling so much now. You know, what I'm saying is there's like often this reason, there's a survival instinct to shut this down, right? And so what is your experience with all that feeling coming up? It sounds like you've prepped yourself really well for it. What's your experience of starting to understand what it's, the sensitivity to your world and you know, this thing that maybe your body initially was like, nope, we can't feel any of that, to have those floodgates open now?
Well, let's say they're not, the floodgates aren't open. I think if the floodgates opened, I'd probably have a bit of a nervous breakdown, I think. It would be pretty full on, I think. But
yeah.
So we've got homework to do from the retreat, and it's following this book called The Presence Process. And it's 15 minutes morning and night of a certain type of breathing. And so it's a breathing exercise where it's a circular breath, so it's in, out, but it's a, anyway, I had the most profound experience with that. That was way better than ayahuasca. But so this breathing, it's just your normal breathing, but you want to be able to hear your breath. So
okay.
You want to hear that, but it's not sped up at all. And what you do as you breathe in and out, you have a mantra. I am in this here now, and that's all you do. And I got to where I was meditating for half an hour cross-legged on a bolster sort of thing, which wasn't easy but wasn't hard. This is really, really hard. But what the book says is things will come up. Just sit with them. And they might come up then, they might come up later on. And the other thing they want you to do after the 15-minute breathing session is ask questions, like put questions out there. You mightn't get the answer back right away, but you will get a question pop into your head. I mean, an answer pop into your head at some point in time. But it's big on when things come up, just sit with them. Mm-hmm. Don't judge them. They're not good or bad. Just sit with them and allow them to do their thing. And so that's, you know, when stuff does come up, I don't, there's no judgment of it. There's no, this shouldn't be happening. It's just like, this is happening. And you just feel it.
Yeah. I believe they call that equanimity. I once upon a time did a 10-day silent meditation retreat, which was very, very hard
for
me.
How was that? Because I've often thought about
God. It was really challenging. And I have a couple of funny stories about it. So one is I would constantly panic that all my animals were dying. That was because you're not supposed to like have a phone or, you know, check in on anybody. And, you know, I would make up. I can be a bit of a worst case scenario person, so I would make up these stories about how my life outside of this space was falling apart. And then I had this hilarious experience, because at dinner time, it's sort of your main meal, and I love food. Like I'm kind of built like little, and so food, you know, I don't miss meals, because otherwise, you know, hypoglycemia, I get very grumpy. And so this one meal, you know, there was a round table that you had to kind of serve at. And I had my plate and my knife and fork in one hand, and I was diving in to get, you know, potatoes or something. And I literally like stabbed this girl in the back with my bread knife, like my dinner knife, as I was lunging to try to, you know, get in this spot. And
as you would around food,
as you would. I mean, I was like, okay, I'm on this, you know, and I was mortified. mortified, to the point where for like 3 days after, I would watch her and watch her eye movements and like, is she looking at me? And I actually had to go and sit with the main teachers and talk it out because I was like so mortified that I had done this. And I mean, I think you know where the story goes. You know, at the end, when we could actually talk, of course, I had to go up and, you know, check in. Oh my gosh, you know, are you okay? Like, this thing happened. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. She turns and looks at me, Warwick, and she goes, oh my God, you mean that I've been here for 10 days trying to build body awareness and like, you know what's happening in my space, and I didn't even notice you stabbed me in the back with your dinner knife?
Oh, that's
funny. I thought it was an excellent lesson. And I look back on it sometimes when I get, you know, in my head about, oh my God, what have I done? Like, this person hates me or whatever it is, right? And I think, you know what? Most people, they just aren't even paying attention. It really is. You know, they're not giving you the time of day. So yeah, that was a big lesson for me. And, you know, it was challenging. It was physically challenging. There was times where I definitely thought my legs were going to fall off because you sit for meditation 6 to 8 hours a day.
Oh, really?
It's very, very intensive. And you get to a point where they ask, do not shift position or move for an hour at a time. That's what you kind of work up to. And that was very hard. I found that very, very challenging. Interestingly enough, my favorite position, which makes sense, was straddled rather than cross-legged. I could do that much more easily. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the horseback riding and stuff obviously kind of helped me out there. But it's actually funny. I was chatting with a girlfriend of mine and I was like, what do you want to know today? And she's like, I want to know his meditation practice. So you've already helped us out there with the presence process and well.
That's what I'm currently doing. I'm struggling with it actually.
Yeah. What was your process before? Like before you got into this current?
What really helped me was the Muse headband. So I think the Muse helped quite a bit. And then I'd always do the Muse sitting in a chair. And then I started doing the Muse cross-legged on a cushion. Oh, that made it twice as hard.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
To maintain that. And in the end, I got up to where I was doing like half an hour every day, cross-legged on the thing. And I think it's the same as what you were talking about. You get to a point where you don't think you can keep doing it. The pain is just painful. And you just got to breathe through that. And there's something about doing that and just staying there and going through that that does something for you. And there's a book I've read. I don't know if you ever read a book called Shantaram.
No, I have not.
It's a novel. I don't read many novels, but this one I was recommended I read it. And it's about an Australian guy that goes to India and lives in the slums in India. But it's an amazing book. It's one of those books you'll read a sentence and you'll stop and stare at the wall for a few minutes. Mm-hmm. Like, it's one of them. And in the book, they go to this place in Mumbai where they have these guys are called the standing babas. They're monks, and they stand all their life. Once you become a monk, you never sit down. Wow. You stand. And they sleep up against a wall in these like harness things that kind of hold them up, but they never sit down. But their legs are swollen and the veins are popping out of them and they're just red and swollen. But these guys have this look of bliss on their face. Like, it's, they get through that pain, that excruciating pain, and come out almost enlightened on the other side. And it's, I kind of think of things like what you did, the 10-day meditation retreat, and just trying to sit still and hold that pose and breathe through that pain, that discomfort. That's, you know, I think there's some growth in that itself.
Oh, absolutely. And I think there's many things kind of modeled after that. I know that one of the things for myself is like I said earlier, like going without a meal is like really challenging for me. So one of the things on my list actually is doing, you know, some sort of a, I don't necessarily want to call it a vision quest, but something where challenging that aspect of myself, you know, because I know it's something I'm very attached to, you know. So I think that's a part of what you're speaking to is this, can I like how deep can my let go be, you know, of releasing the attachment to certain things like comfort, physical comfort. Even I guess the Wim Hof is in that vein, right? The, you know, cold water and things, you know, going.
Yeah. I have a chest freezer and I do daily ice baths in that chest freezer. And it's the same thing. It's acceptance. It's just, it's just that cold. If you fight the cold, it fights back.
It does.
But if you just accept it, it's not near as bad. It's kind of a lesson in acceptance.
That's beautiful. So I want to track it back around to this horse work and, you know, that you're doing, because in parallel to all this self work you're doing is the horse work. And this might be the reason why, you know, when I've been watching your most recent videos, I watched the one, the creating connection through changing focus, the video series. And that was the one that I was like, oh, my nervous system is very happy right now, just watching the settledness and the slowness and the awareness and presence in that. So I'd love to know how, obviously we're in a weird year with COVID and everything that's going on. We're not teaching, you know, clinics in the same way as we were and things. With the horses that you are working with, how is this landing for them?
Really good. I mean, the thing with all this stuff is I'm going back through all of my horses too and having to start from the beginning, because I've kind of been working on this stuff for a few years with them now. I just kind of see deeper and deeper truths in the whole thing. But that that creating connection through change in focus, it's weird, because the stuff I'm doing falls outside of the four quadrants. The relationship stuff is not negative reinforcement. It's not positive reinforcement. It's not negative punishment. It's not punishment, positive punishment. Like say, like I don't usually take outside horses in for training. I haven't done that for 5 years because I'm usually traveling too much. But so I've taken in a few horses here because I want to video some stuff. And so I've got a Mustang here that has been under saddle for a number of years, but they got to a point to where she will not want to go forward. And if you ask her to go forward, she'll pin her ears and kick out. When she first got here, she's a horse that will just fence pace, looking off into the distance, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And I tried to interrupt that by doing that creating connection through change in focus, which I go in there with a flag and I just try to wave that flag in an interesting way. So there's no pressure involved, but it just kind of draws their attention. But the owner of this horse, when she first bought it here, I said, just show me what you do with her. And one of the things she does is she lunges her because she's scared that she's going to do something silly. So she wants to lunge and get all the energy out. And she chases around with the flag and this mare won't go.
Right.
So this mare won't even look at the flag. She actually pins her ears at the flag or did. And so it's like, I can't do that. And then I thought, well, I'll just match steps with you. So she paced back and forth along the fence, which was about 30 or 40 feet. And I just stayed probably 20 or 30 feet away from her. I just walked parallel with her and I just matched steps with her. I went in there every day for about half an hour or so and matched steps with her till she let me know that she was aware of me. She made a change. You know, usually she'd stop and leave the fence and come over and say hi for 2 seconds and then she'd go back to it. And right then I go, okay, that's enough for one day. And I had been either doing that in the pasture she lives in, or I'd put her in the round pen and she'd pace in the round pen and I'd walk back and forth in the round pen. And so she'd been here about 8 days, I think, and her owners, she got two owners, and they came down to see her. And I said, well, we'll just put her in the round pen and I'll show you what we've been doing. I put her in the round pen and this is the day she doesn't pace back and forth. And so I walk in there and she just comes up and hangs with me. And so then I she might walk off, but I match steps with her, but she's not pacing at all. So I had one of the owners come in and I said, just stand there. And if she hangs with you, good. If she walks off, just match steps with her. Just let her know that you are aware of what she's doing. You're aware of what your body's doing and you have no expectations. So you did that for a bit. And then the other owner said, I want to try. So she went in there, she did it for a bit, and then the mare stopped with her, and then the mare laid in and went to sleep.
Oh my goodness.
And so it was 8 days of just matching steps with her. before she stopped fence pacing. Now she doesn't fence pace at all. I've got her in with another horse now. And if I take the other horse out, she just stays there. She doesn't fence pace. And some people go, well, why didn't you put in with another horse in the first place? And the reason I didn't is because the owner, she has a way of viewing the world. Mm-hmm. And I knew if I put another horse in with her, and then I did the matching steps and got her to not pace anymore, she would say, oh, it's only because another horse is in with her. So I kept the other horse out of there and I kept her on her own till I solved the issue so that she couldn't say, oh, it's just because the other horse. Because changing people's perceptions about this stuff can be kind of hard. So she's been interesting and she's been through the whole gamut, what I realize now is that she was quite shut down. And so for the last, and when the lady bought her here, she did some groundwork with her, then she saddled her up and got on and ride her, and the mare saddled up just fine, was easy to saddle. Well, she's been here for probably a month or 6 weeks or something or other. After I went through opening her up and getting her seeing the world again, she's hard to saddle.
I was going to say that. She's thawing out.
Yeah. Oh my goodness! Yeah, so the saddling process might take an hour every day.
Yep.
And it's been getting good. And yesterday I thought, I'm going to actually ride it today. And so we started video on the session, and she'd regressed back to, well, the saddling went well, but then with moving around with the saddle, and then she's back to bucking with the saddle again, being real tight about stuff. Yep. And what was interesting yesterday is what I've been doing with her is if she gets tight and has a bit of a buck, I don't do anything. I don't chase her or anything. I just let her do it. When she stops, I wait for her to stop and lick her lips before I ask her to do anything.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yep. And yesterday when we were videoing it, it looked to me like she will just get tight and stop. Now I think because she thinks she can stop. It's kind of a go-to to go into that freeze mode.
Totally.
And my wife my wife's doing a very deep dive into this whole nervous system stuff. And she was videoing yesterday. And I said, into the microphone. I said, so what I'm going to do today, see, she's trying to stop right there. I'm not going to let her stop. I'm going to have her keep going. Yep. What I wanted to do is start to try to find some peace while she's moving. Yep. And she'd kind of want to tighten up and I'd have a go again. And she'd want to tighten up and stop and have a go again. I kept this going until then she was going around tight. And I kept it going until she started to go around and not be tense while she was moving.
Mm.
And then I finally let her stop. And when she stopped, she did some things she's not done before. Big old big deep breaths and shaking her head and full body shakes and just really resetting her nervous system. I wouldn't suggest doing that from the beginning. I think before she kind of needed to freeze and let go of a little bit. But I did that for so long. I thought, okay, I think it's time to expand your horizons. I'm not going to let you stand still and work through it. I'm going to see if you can work through it while you're moving.
Wow.
I'm not sure it would have been good for her in the beginning to do that. But yesterday, the stuff that came out of it, like the big old, big old deep breaths and letting stuff out and shaking, and she yawns a lot and does all that sort of stuff, but yesterday was the first time she'd had that big full body release.
Amazing. I you start to think about it as far as the nervous system and trauma and stress, and it just makes a lot of sense, right? Like if you start to kind of look through that lens, it's like she's kind of got her gears stuck at the, getting caught by the lion and I'm going to die, it's like, okay, what are the ways that we can work her past, help her past that essentially into the movement space. And it sounds like that's exactly what was going on there. So, maybe another trainer might've done that in a different way, like got to move her feet, but from a forceful way. But it sounds like for you with that nervous system information on hand, you were able to actually support her into a healthier nervous system balance, into more regulation than she may have previously had. So I think that's really cool.
Yeah, that once you really understand that whole nervous system stuff, for me, it's really changed the way I go about, like I said it before, way I go about training horses, and that whole tapping into that ventral vagal complex, tapping into that social engagement thing. So tapping into that, letting them know you see things. You know, there's an old Ray Hunt saying that says they know when you know and they know when you don't. And I used to think that saying meant they know when you know what you're doing and they know when you don't know what you're doing. A few years ago, I read an article by someone who was around Ray Hunt a lot. And he said, when you're around a horse, you need to be aware of their eyes and aware of their ears and aware of their nostrils and aware of their muzzle and aware of their back and aware of their tail. Mm-hmm. Is it up? Is it down? Is it tight? Is it clamped? Aware of their breathing. You need to be aware of their feet. You need to be aware of all that stuff. You need to you need to be aware of what's going on. You need to know what all those things are doing, because they know when you know and they know when you don't. Mm. They basically know when you are present. They know when you are reading the situation. They know if you are thinking about what's for dinner. They know if you're on your phone. They know all that stuff. And a lot of the little things they do, I think, are almost tests to see if we're listening.
Are you paying attention?
Are you paying attention? Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of what horses do is they give you little signals to know, to see if you're listening. If you're not listening, they go, okay, I get it. I can deal with that too. I just need to know, who are you?
Yep.
You know, I'll deal with you on different levels depending on how you deal with me. Do I need to just go inside myself and just be obedient? I can do that.
Yep.
Do you want the whole horse? I can do that too.
Do I need to be the one that's watching out all the time, or can you take on some of that, right? Like, I think they look for that. I know when I take my mare out into the woods, she's like, okay, you need to actually help me on cougar duty as well. Right? You brought me out here, so I need you to be on board in a team with all this stuff, right? So, yeah.
And I really think that learning to do that with horses is, because we don't do that these days. You know, we're not present. When we're driving, we're thinking about something else. You know, we're not in the moment, and horses need us to be in the moment. And it's, I think, you know, you've really gone down the woo-woo path where you've got into animal communication. And I think, you know who Kerry Lake is?
Oh, that name rings a bell. Yeah.
So she's basically an animal communicator, but she teaches people how to do it.
Yep.
And she says, I'm not teaching you anything. I'm just helping you remember.
Absolutely.
We all had the ability to do this. And I think doing this stuff with horses the way I'm doing it now is like the first step to that is starting to be aware. You become aware of them. You become aware of you. And when you have that awareness, then your antenna gets turned on and you can start to receive information from outside of you. Mm-hmm. But I think the first step is to do that. And the funny thing with horses is, you know, a lot of people have told me that, oh, since I started doing what you do with horses, it's totally changed my life and my husband and my kids and whatever. Mm-hmm. But I guarantee you those people, and I'm one of them too, wouldn't have done it for their husband or their wife or their kids or their boss or their whatever. But we're passionate enough about horses that we'll make some changes if it helps with the horse. And those are changes that help us with everything else. And I really think that some of this stuff, you know, just being aware with the horses makes some changes that we need, but we wouldn't do them ourselves.
Yeah, absolutely.
For any other reason. Yeah. Sorry. But
yeah.
Finish that off.
Yeah, I can definitely testify to that. Yeah. You know, I felt when my mare Diva came into my life. We've been together for 17 years now. She's 21 this year. And I guess all I can say is at the time I was pretty shut down, but I had this one feeling that I couldn't shake, and that was like this sense that we absolutely had to be together. Like it was destined, so to speak. And there's my woo-woo coming out, right? But I've met people, you know, I call them heart horse pairs. You know, it's just like they've come together to do all sorts of interesting things and learn all sorts of stuff. And, you know, it was that feeling that actually kind of kept me on the path, you know, because it was really hard. You know, it's been really, really challenging. There was lots of parts, other parts of me that were ready to get on out of there. But it was that feeling. And it sounds like, you know, for you with some of these horses as well, like Sherlock, you know, that sense of like, wow, you're here to teach me something. Like, I don't quite know what it is, but uh, but there's something here. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm a big believer in you get the horse you need when you need him.
Yeah.
You know, horses come into your life for a reason. I think people do. I mean, everything happens for a reason. But it's been quite the journey, and it's one of those things you couldn't have told me 5 years ago you need to do this.
Yep.
I think it's stuff you have to fall into it. You have to find it for yourself. It's not something that someone can tell you. Someone can plant a seed by all means, but no one can lead you to it and say, stick your nose in this.
Yeah.
I think you've got to, you know, you've really got to find it yourself.
You sure do. Yeah. That experiential piece, right? Like you see, oh, wow, that, you know, like with the Mustang, that worked. Something worked there, you know, like, I got to go back and check that out, you know? So yeah, it sounds like you talk about yourself on a journey. You're definitely on a journey right now. And it's a very exciting one. I mean, I'm very inspired. My recent mare that's come into my life is a Canadian horse. I would say she's kind of in the shutdown category a little bit more so. My other mare is very dramatic. Her name is Diva. So she's very, you know, everything's very expressed. But, you know, I went out and played yesterday with your, you know, changing focus exercise with Raven and found, you know, there's some things moving and shifting. So I know I'm appreciative of this exploration you're doing in the world of horses and how it's kind of, I can see the ripples. I can see the ripples of how this is going to change a lot of lives in a good way. And there's always something that really lights up in me and gets me all teary when I think about that. So I just want to say, Warwick, thank you for your work.
I think everything happens a certain way for a reason. And the stuff that I'm talking about these days is it's a bit out there. But a lot of people seem to be resonating with it. And I really think that I had to be quite mainstream to start with.
Yeah.
To get people to kind of be interested in what I have to say.
Absolutely, engaged.
And then I had to slowly head off into the woo-woo, and they came with me. And then I went a bit further into the woo-woo and they came with me. And and now they're fully engaged in the woo-woo. But I think from where I was to where I am now, you don't make that step. That step is not
– Nope.
That step doesn't happen easily. And so if you're at a certain place and then woo-woo is way over there, you look at that and you go, can't even see myself going there. And so I think the way it all worked, it seems like I'm meant to entice people into the woo, the way it was all laid out to where I'm pretty mainstream to start with, and people believe what I have to say. And then I just slowly make that drift off into the woo and people kind of follow me.
Yeah. Nice little bridge for them to cross over. Right.
And I'm a kind of a slow learner. And so a lot of people have started down, you know, followed me down the woo path, and then whoa, they've jumped way ahead of me.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's
cool.
Great. That's fine. But I some people can like really get into something and read vast amounts of information, take it all in. I couldn't take a test on it.
Yeah.
Afterwards. What it tends to do is plant seeds in me, and then I try things and experience things and now it kind of
mm-hmm.
works. So.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I've so appreciated our chat today, Warwick, and I'm looking forward to sharing this with my listeners because I know that there's lots of gold here to be mined from what we've chatted about. And I really wish you well on this whole adventure. I'm excited to see what comes next and where you take this. Thank you for being here today.
No worries at all. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no, before we go, with love, you've shared some great resources today about meditation, the presence process, the muse. Anything else that you, you know, you've been loving lately that, you know, you might want to share with my listeners?
A book I'm reading called Calling Us Home. And it's a book on, basically it's a book on shamanism, but it's just about how to reconnect to everything. It's a beautiful book, and it's got It's got like exercises to do, and I'll give you a little quick rundown on some of the stuff. But one of the things I want you to do is for a meditation is just go out and sit in nature and just observe. Just sit there and observe. That's one of the exercises. Then you're going to go sit in nature, sit there and just listen and see what you can listen to. Then one of the exercises, you sit in nature and you sit there and you just feel somatic experiences. You just feel what your body feels. But then after a while, what you do is you start to combine them all. You go sit in nature and he wants you to take in, you know, like 20% of what's coming into you is through your vision and 20% is through your hearing and 60% is through the felt sensation. He wants you to feel, he wants you to get messages from nature.
Yes.
And it's such cool stuff. It's a really well-written book. And a few neighbors over from us has a big stand of eucalyptus trees and there's all these turkey vultures living there, and they circle around here a lot, and I'll be outside and I'll just look up and I'll see one of those turkey vultures and I'll just watch it for 30 seconds or a minute, just wherever it goes, and just not thinking about anything, just and I tell myself, yeah, good medicine, that one was good medicine, or you know, a fly or a butterfly.
Oh, totally.
Anything, just stop and just I think they come along for a reason. I tell you what, I'll be walking along in my head planning all this stuff. I'm going to do this and this and this. And then a butterfly shows up and I stop. And all that goes away and I'll just observe the butterfly. Well, we have a few hummingbirds. Any hummingbirds do the same thing too. But yeah, that's one. It's a really, really cool book.
Oh, I love that.
I'm kind of loving that book.
Okay, I'm going to check that out. And how do people get in touch? I know there's a few ways to get in touch with you, Warwick.
My website, www.warwickschiller.com. Mm-hmm. I have a couple of Facebook group that's Warwick Schiller Performance Horsemanship. And then I have a Facebook page, fan page, which is the same name. And, you know, you can message me on any of those.
So we'll send people along to there. And it's been a real pleasure. I've really enjoyed chatting with you about you know, the adventure you've been on lately. And like I said, I'll be watching for you know, where it goes to next.
Well, thanks for having me. It's been a great chat.
Wonderful. Thanks, Warwick. We'll talk to you soon.